I'll call the meeting to order because I guess it really is an ordinance committee meeting. Announce that there's audio video recording, some of which has been going on for a while, so that'll make for colorful minutes. And this is an ordinance committee meeting. Counselor Ryan O'Donnell and Counselor David Murphy, we're from the ordinance committee. Counsel Maureen Carney couldn't be here tonight. But it's also posted as a full city council meeting, so we have Council President Dwight here, Counselor Scaris here, and Counselor Adams is here to participate in the discussion about council rules. Now, did we continued our rule, the tree, was it the tree thing we were still working on? Continue that to our next meeting or to today?
We continued to our next meeting, but I think because we didn't update the agenda, we're safer just to do it at our next meeting.
Well, it's coming in the winter, the trees aren't going anywhere, so.
Counselor Adams and I just want to have a two-year-long ordinance. That's our goal.
All right, for those of you that weren't here, we had several versions of the ordinance, none of which actually reflected its current state of the art, and we wanted to not send it to council until we had a final version that had everything in it that was supposed to be and the stuff that wasn't not in it. And I kind of thought it might come back tonight, but it never did, right? So.
Well, Carolyn did forward me the item, but as Counselor O'Donnell says, I didn't update the agenda.
Okay, so we'll deal with it. The trees will wait a month. There's no public comment because there's no public here. We're the only ones in the room. So we'll go forward with the continued review of the city council rules, and we find ourselves up to 4.5 orders of business, and we're going to keep going because you were all here for the last one. So, oh, you weren't? Well, what I was doing the last time was simply reading through each section, and then we all threw in some feedback as to what we thought of it, and when we had some consensus, we moved on to the next one.
It doesn't have to be now, but I was going to speak at public comment and just give some of my feedback. So
Feel free if you want
to. Now,
why don't you? Because you have to run before we're all going to leave. So okay. If you want to put it all on record, just go ahead now.
Sure.
Get it on record. And
for one, I appreciate that there's an overhaul. Last overhaul was done 3 years ago, and I think it's good to do it in a couple of years. So I'm really glad that we're doing this. I think we should aim to do it every couple of years. I wrote a list of comments.
Is that the one we had before? Because we've had that, and as we went through each section that we were related to, we did read it.
I won't go over all of them because everyone has it. Except to say that, one, I feel very, comment number one, I feel very strongly about. And for me, I won't support, if that rule remains, I won't support it. I don't think it, I explained why in that rule. That's a poison pill for me. I couldn't support it unless we amend that rule and take that out. The other ones I don't really feel very strongly about. They're just points. None of them really are, deal breakers for me. But I do feel pretty strongly about point number six that I made, that if we're going to have fewer committees, that it may make sense to have four counselors on each one. And rule seven, solicitor will weigh in on that. But there are other points that I just wanted to raise because I think that, these are just new points that I think in some cases are due to changes since the last time, since I wrote this. I think the new numbering system is a little bit cumbersome. The old rules are just numbered straight through, 1 through 40, 50, whatever. Because if you, just practically speaking, if we're on the council floor and someone wants to suspend a rule, it's kind of cumbersome and bizarre to be like, I'd like to suspend rule, just for example, 2.6.2, rather than, 37 or whatever. That's small, but it's a point I think we should consider. Other points. 2.6.3, I know we're taking, we're going out of our way, and it's important to do this to make sure that we're not having a meeting with full council where we don't need to. It may be difficult for a chair in the event that they don't know which councilors are going to attend. Because if you think, for example, it's a regular council meeting, say ordinance just doesn't realize that two councilors are going to pop in, it's said, well, what do you do then? The meeting's posted. You can't really ask the counselors to leave. Probably can't really ask them not to speak. May not work if you do ask them. So I don't know what to do. We should think about that scenario, because it makes sense if we know, like tonight, we know other counselors are going to come, but other nights we might not know.
Can I make a commentary point real quick?
Please, yeah.
I mean, especially if we have a committee membership that's all four. That way, if one person shows up, then you...
It's going to trip it more off.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
Yeah. So, we should think about that. The only other thing that I have for now is that, in addition to what I said before, is that Rule 3.2. I don't know if this was discussed, but I don't think that rule really makes sense. If a council wanted to, at any point, or even on a yearly basis, create a resolution that states what they think the state legislative priority should be, maybe that would be a good idea, but I don't really see it as, I don't see it as a good idea to have that as a rule.
Mm-hmm. But that would be like all it could be is like a resolution, right?
It certainly could be, but I don't know why we would mandate it by a rule to have to do a particular resolution on a yearly basis. And I don't know who would take the lead on that. I don't know if this would require, you know, if the council president would take the lead or just delegate someone, or if a council would volunteer or a group of counselors, or if the city council is going to have a special meeting to take it up.
Well, probably the Legislative Affairs Committee would.
Would bring it to council.
Draft it, yeah.
Also, it requires that it's submitted to the mayor per 3.6. 3.6 talks about how the mayor basically is in charge of, well, it talks about the mayor's duties, enforcing ordinances, running the city on a day-to-day basis. I'm not quite sure what the mayor would do with it. Because certainly, obviously, the mayor has no power to enforce it. So I don't really think that having a statement, a mandated by council rule, yearly statement stating what the council thinks the state legislative priority should be, really makes sense. Oh, and the final thing that I just wanted to raise was 2.6.2.5, if that exists. I might have gotten this right.
Power to amend?
Yeah, that's it. That's right. Right now, well, that rule I don't really have a problem with, but it would be nice to, unless this is required by another rule, to see what recommendation was made by each committee. So when the ordinance committee gets all these recommendations and they figure out what to take or what to leave, the council could just get that information as well to see what the ordinance committee looked at before they made their decision.
And I know the most common ordinance that we see, other than zoning, goes through transportation and parking. You know, we do a lot of ordinances on moving parking spaces and putting signs in, you know, that kind of thing, parking garage stuff, that usually when it comes back, we'll often have Councilor O'Donnell, you know. So I think we're doing this now for the most part, but it certainly doesn't hurt to put it in here to say that it has to happen, because a lot of times it'll come out and we'll, in ordinance, will incorporate a recommendation from transportation and parking and maybe something from Andrew or, you know, whoever commented, to blend the final ordinance with the feedback from those different committees that weighed in on it. I mean, that's the one nice thing about actually using the committee structure, is that almost every counselor, it's a benefit to us, and almost any counselor in one of the committees has seen and thought about and commented on each ordinance before it gets back to the full body. Because then when it comes up there, they're familiar with it. It's not a first time thing. And we're not doing committee work all over again, because they've already looked at it in one of the committees that it got referred to. So it seems really helpful. I mean, that was always my concern with Councilor Freeman Daniels when he dropped something on us in the 11th hour that had never gone to committee, because nobody got a chance to weigh in on it or understand it. You know, that was a tough thing. But I think, I mean, what's everyone's opinion? I think in practice, that's kind of what we do now.
I would also point out that a couple paragraphs down, we have language about how each committee is reporting to the full city council, and then that includes the recommendation and any votes and amendments and related documents. So in theory, I could see that it should be clarified, but in theory, yeah, all the committees are transmitting all their stuff back. So we should be able to see that and get it back.
And we do in our packets, you know, we are approving minutes of committees, but it would be really helpful if the minutes for things that are action items at night are there, because a lot of times we're approving, you know, minutes from a long time ago. And it would be helpful, again, if we're doing something and Ed Lou asked Ordinance to change something, that we could see the minutes from Ed Lou and see what they were talking about. You know, so when we're voting on it, we could look at the Ed Lou minutes and say, oh yeah, that discussion was had in Ed Lou, and this is what they recommended. You know, but that, I remember in the past, was always a problem until we had Pam doing the minutes, that the minutes sort of wandered in whenever they wandered in, when we were writing them ourselves.
I think the reality, though, is that if you saw the minutes of an Ed Lou meeting when the city council was taking up an item, it wouldn't reflect the minutes that were approved by the committee.
Mm-hmm. Because they wouldn't have cycled yet.
They wouldn't have met to.
Yeah, they may not have met to approve their own minutes.
So I wonder if there is a way to have the committee minutes, you know, available for a city council meeting and have
pre-approval.
Have those be approved during the city council meeting. I mean, is that a possibility? Because it would make sense that, you know, it doesn't make sense to me that all of the stuff that I write in the reports is already outdated before it gets seen by the city council with, you know, that includes votes and reports and recommendations.
I don't know, insofar that they're not officially convening as that committee to approve, do we have to let them go in session within session?
I know, that's really the question.
If we do that, we have to, I don't know if we could, because we have to post.
Yeah, that committee meeting.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
Isn't all we need just the recommendation and the vote? We don't need like the whole discussion. It'd be nice, but.
Yeah, the discussion's helpful though, because, you know, if I'm thinking I got an issue with something that somehow I managed to be on a committee that never talked about it, I could review, you know, the committee minutes and say, oh yeah, they talked about my issue. And I could look at what the conversation was and say, oh yeah, I guess I agree with that. You know, I really don't have to have, we don't have to have that discussion now again in council, because I see that that concern was discussed and what was, you know, how it came to be the way it is. I mean, I might decide I want to have it anyway, but I might decide I don't, because it's already been hashed out at the committee level. But it's true, if those minutes haven't really been approved by the committee yet, then they're technically it would be for our use to familiarize ourselves with the discussion. But you'd have to ask, hey, you know, I think part of it, and I remember you're talking about it relative to the Roth issue, was, you know, having, if it isn't a unanimous vote of a committee, what was the issue the dissenting members of that committee had, and am I concerned about that? You know, yeah, there was a positive recommendation, but if it's 3-2, or, you know, 3-1, if it's a four-member committee, how strongly do I feel about the objection of that one person, and do I want to give it life at council?
I mean, you know, the thing, and as you said, I mean, this frequently comes up with planning, and we usually have to ask Carolyn what the disposition of the debate was, what the division was, what were the objections, what were the pros. Mm-hmm. So we're relying on one person. Mm-hmm. For their description, and she, you know, no one seems to have objected so far. No, that's not true. Some people have objected in the past about her characterization of what the meeting was like. So,
and we don't ever see their minutes. In fact,
right.
You know, I don't know how up to date their minutes are. I know I've had one constituents go crazy about CPC commission because their minutes lag forever.
Right.
You know, and yet we're voting on it, but we only have usually Sarah Valley telling us what they did and what they said, because those meeting minutes, the chain of that isn't even done yet. So, but I mean, these are just our rules on our committees. So.
For every committee that is a council committee, obviously the council would be here and be able to speak to what happened. Mm-hmm. In the committee as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if it's, you know, I know this last night, we sent some things forward with no recommendation to council, but we'll be there to say, you know, like Councilor O'Donnell was there to say why TNP sent something forward and no recommendation, he could tell us why.
Yeah.
You know, so we could move forward going, oh, you know, no reason to hold it up for that, we'll just, if anyone asks the council, we can tell them. But I think, to me, that's important, but true, if it's a council committee, you can ask, because the members are here.
Yeah, and also, even if no minutes have been approved yet, whatever the committee has approved or sent out is final. Any amendments, any votes, I mean, that's for us to see.
That's not gonna change.
That's, you know, that's approved, because we don't have to wait for the minutes to be approved. So the minutes is more for the conversation, the subjective, you know, and the debate.
And, yeah, document.
And I don't know how you do that, and I don't know how you, yeah, and I don't know how you require like an executive commission to do that.
But then, anyway, that Roth, that we talked about Roth, and just making sure that when council acts, if there's a minority position, and again, it's gonna be a council committee.
Right.
But councilors that didn't consent to whatever the motion was couldn't tell us why, so we could know.
Well, ironically, his objections came out of a planning board and a conservation commission.
Yeah, and those are gonna be the tough ones, because their minutes usually aren't done by the time it hits us.
Right.
And we have to rely on a staff person.
There's the rub.
Yeah. We could start, if it's something questionable, we can always ask them to bring the chair, ask her to bring the chair in, because I know when we had the school, we just had the school committee here and they brought the chair, and I think that was helpful, not a staff person who could tell us the sentiment of that body as chair.
Right, and that's why having the vote would be good, because if you see a close vote, then you may want to do that. But if it's not, if it's a lopsided vote, then there's no reason to go track down that.
Anything else you wanted to from your list, or shall we start with?
No, I think all the points are right there. So no need for me to elaborate. Thank you.
Okay. So we have been moving around here, but we are up to where? Past there now. We're up to what, 4-4 consent?
4-4,
I think. 4-4 was where we left off, right?
We did 4-4.
Or 4-5. Order of business is where we are. All right, I'll read off order of business. And the order of business at every regular meeting of the council shall be as follows. Roll call, public hearings, recognitions and 1-minute announcements by councilors, communications and proclamations from the mayor, resolutions, and the change, I think, was
I moved.
Recognitions in 1 minute, you moved up.
Yeah. Is it okay if I jump in with like
Sure, yeah, please, because most of this is.
I always thought it was strange that the mayor gets to address the council before the councilors make their own announcements. So I propose separating that from resolutions and putting that right before communications from the mayor. Mm-hmm. It doesn't really matter.
Any feedback on that one? Because usually it doesn't take long. As I know, our last reorganization, we were trying to get the audience's business done so that they didn't have to sit around all night, and that would really delay that. So then resolutions, presentations, and then the consent agenda, approval of minutes, licenses, reports of committees, and appointments. And we were chatting before you folks got here, just about appointments, and perhaps we should distinguish between reappointments and first-time appointments, and perhaps put first-time appointments on the regular agenda and reappointments for known people in the consent agenda. I mean, obviously, we could take somebody out if we were concerned or leave them in. Do you all have any feedback on that one?
I kind of like that suggestion. I just think that the other ones are like extremely routine, and appointments are typically routine, and I think reappointments fall into the very routine category.
Because they're known commodities at that point, and usually for reappointments, you know, the staff person says they come, they participate, they're constructive. The chair probably has said that they're good and they want them back. You haven't feel one way or the other?
My only concern and it's not critical, but you'll notice that when we're reading these appointments, that their term begins a month past when we're first announcing it, you know, in many cases, you know. We're announcing people with terms who are starting in October. I'm announcing it in November meeting. That means, in all likelihood, that the committee is being underserved. I don't know to what, I mean, some of these committees were, you know, like three or four appointments, a significant portion of the committee, so. I mean, I don't have any complaints, but I, well, some people have been kind of anxious to get some, the tree committee, actually, for one, was, you know, once this happening, when people get appointed and so on. So, I don't know.
Although a lot of the times, we don't control when the mayor makes the appointment.
Right.
So it could be coming to us late to begin with, because I know we try and act on them at our next meeting. We couldn't do these because our next meeting was so soon after the council meeting.
Right.
There's like that 7-day delay, we have
right.
to wait, but we try to get them out quick, but the mayor, and usually their appointments say, you know, until their replacement is named. I mean, I don't think they end.
Well, like I'm a council on aging, actually, in a lot of cases, there's actually some of the people have died.
That pretty much ended.
Vacant, yeah. And, that doesn't happen with all the other committees, but.
Yeah, I don't actually remember the city committees. I know on the state committees, your appointment runs until your replacement is qualified and sworn in to appear, so the committee keeps functioning. So,
even but usually the things that we're seeing are like midterm resignations
yeah.
for a variety of reasons.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
stuff.
But for the end of someone's term,
yeah,
I suppose if their term is up and they want to go, they can just say, hasta la vista, I'm not showing up anymore. But for like reappointments, they usually continue to serve until they get sworn in again.
Well, this I haven't heard it as a problem.
Before we get to the next group, I can just ask a question. Is the automatic recognition of the mayor removed?
No. In fact, it adds department heads.
No. Because I don't know if the rule should be changed, but I don't necessarily think that I wrote the rule, and I'm not as supportive as I once was. But it may not be the rule that's the rule that's an issue. Let me give an example. When the mayor is recognized, what's typically customarily happening is that the mayor speaks whenever the mayor wants. And I think, let me give an example to illustrate what I'm talking about. When we were talking about the Nonotuck School, I moved to recognize
Paige
Brody. The mayor jumped up and spoke for about 10 minutes, cutting off every argument he could foresee her making. And nearly, at the end of it, we nearly forgot, and I had to remind us that there was a motion to recognize Ms. Brody. So, the mayor isn't chair anymore. The mayor presents to us. And I don't want to create a situation where that can be used so that the mayor's speaking whenever the mayor wants to, and in that manner. Because I find that inappropriate. So I just want to point that out.
Well, I mean, there's, you know, there's having to vote to allow the individual to speak, and then there's recognition by the chair that it's your turn to talk.
I was going to say, that was on me, and you'll notice I did have to cut off the mayor when he kept interrupting you and not allowing you to finish your sentence.
That's right, I appreciate it.
I mean,
it's
maybe it's not the rule.
I think that's the presiding officer.
But
we're supposed to manage and control debate, and so that was on me. I think that, and I noted that, and I talked about it with him afterwards.
Note to self.
Well, it's just, yeah. He gets anxious and he gets in, you know, and always likes a good debate. But the problem is you're right. He preempts other people. He doesn't wait till recognized. He has to be recognized by the chair, whoever the presiding officer is. He doesn't require recognition by everyone every time he needs to speak. But I think it's appropriate to say, it's your turn. Hang on a second. Now you may speak, and now you may speak.
Because of that sense, we're members of the body. We're always recognized as eligible to speak, but we have to wait our turn for the chair
right.
to say it's your turn. And the mayor's the same way. I mean, he's not a member of the body, and he's recognized
right.
to speak at our meeting,
right.
but only when the chair says it's your turn.
Man, there's a difference between deliberators and testifiers and stuff, but the fact is that they, to maintain order, everyone should have their opportunity to speak.
When recognized.
Whether they're testifying or whether they're deliberating. So.
So the consent agenda, again, and we've noted that perhaps we want to make a discrimination between appointments, initial appointments and reappointments. Recess for Finance Committee, which changed, the name changed to Committee on Finance.
Right.
Approval of minutes of Committee on Finance.
Not so you can approve the minutes.
All, that's all the minutes, isn't it?
What's that?
Because you finance, when you recess for Finance, when you come out of Finance, that's normally when we approve other minutes too, isn't it?
No, we traditionally approve them before that.
And that's the problem, because after you approve your minutes in Finance, we have to wait for a whole other, some administrative assistance like this.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because Finance has to approve its minutes.
Right.
So this just is
done right away. Then financial orders, which were just done in Finance, usually. And then second readings. Orders, ordinances, updates from the council president, committee chairs, information requests, and study requests, and new business. So really the only change in the order was moving up recognitions and 1 minute announcements a little bit, and then inserting a consent agenda, right? And everything else was
and approval of finance.
And approval of finance minutes, which. So anything more to this one? We can keep moving?
Yeah.
All right.
Only a comment on, well, Councilor Adams gone, but I should have done it while I was here, but only my thinking on the appointments, certainly there should be no distinction in terms of referrals, whether it's new or a reappointment.
Because the charter speaks to that.
That should be on the consent agenda. Yeah. We don't need to debate a referral separately. And I would just push back a little bit on reappointments. I think they should be treated the same, because otherwise we're just presuming that if someone's on there, it almost gives them presumption that they should continue.
Mm-hmm.
But it's debatable. So.
And but they would be, theoretically, when they're in the consent agenda, they'd be back from the appointments committee, or whichever committee, I don't remember which one now does appointments. But it would seem to me if that committee has a question, they would be taking it out of the consent agenda anyway.
Well, which is true with no appointments as well.
As well.
Right. Yeah.
So I guess we could leave it with
the original argument, which is essentially, if it seems pro forma, if it's not, then, or if anything, mm-hmm. is slightly yeah. off color, then you have the opportunity to remove them from.
So that yeah. committee would be the gatekeeper for is right. it in the consent agenda or not.
Right.
And on top of that, any counselor could ask that it be pulled off. And actually, it's a very gentle way to flag a problem. So I'd really like to discuss this separately.
Mm-hmm.
Or be like, oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, and I can really only remember one time for that happening. So
right.
to my way of thinking, once in 10 years, the consent agenda is probably fine, because if somebody's got an issue, they'll take it out. So, 4.5.2, the agenda shall be published in this manner and adhered to at all meetings. The presiding officer may implement a change of the order of business, unless any singular council objects, in which case the rules may be suspended as provided in the rules. 4.6, minutes of previous meetings. The administrative assistant to the city council shall submit the minutes of the previous meeting with the council agenda for the next regular scheduled meeting of the city council. 4.7, conduct. City councilors and members of the public shall conduct themselves with civility and respect at all times.
Strike that.
It's interesting, this came up while I was first on the council. It was also when I had suggested, when there was a complete absence of civility in the public comment and some absence of civility on the council floor, and I had proposed a civility change in the rules. The ACLU weighed in, the Lumen weighed in, a number of other people weighed in on how that was suppression of speech. And we've always been, so we couldn't insist on it, we could only ask for it.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, what constitutes one person's sense of civility and respect is another person's sarcastic, passive-aggressive insult. So it's hard to say, and this is so ambiguous in some level, it's really hard to manage, although I like it in there simply because it at least implies that that is the desire. But I don't know if you could actually challenge anyone on this rule for violation of the rule.
Mm-hmm. And then we do, you know, and we do leave ourselves open as elected people to people being able to lambast us pretty much any way they want to.
Right.
I think it's only, you know, fair.
Well, the big problem happened when there were people going after individuals who were not affiliated with the city, who were not elected officials, who were not subject to these things, and or appointed people. The assessor comes to mind, as you recall. Mm-hmm. There was some pretty ugly stuff that was being said that was ad hominem and personal, had nothing to do with the function of the job, and the mayor continually tried to rule it out of order. Right? And then you'll recall when Mayor Ford was dealing with Smith Vocational and with the fire department at the time, and things got really ugly. It got really, really ugly. And, you know, but there really is no way to control that. Okay. She's an elected official, she's subject to those things.
You're subject to it, and you know, you get thick enough skin after a while.
Yeah.
But,
no,
it's hard for, and truly, you know, the member of the public that's up there at that point probably making a fool of themselves. You would like to think that they don't realize it then, they're gonna realize it after 2 weeks of reruns when people tell them, you know, next time you wanna be a phonehead, go to the VFW and not council.
Claire's argument was that if you're speaking of an employee, that's a completely different thing. And I would agree with that. It's a completely different thing. It didn't get, no other employee in any other enterprise is subject to public defamation. And so it's true. And plus, the fact that we're not allowed to deliberate an employee status. And you recall that Councilor LaBarge was trying to get Wayne Fiden fired and so on and so forth, and some of those things really step out of the bounds of just a fair conversation, but I don't know if they qualify for disability or not.
Mm-hmm. So just to jump into the next paragraph on this point, one thing I did take out from the current rules is a clause that said, essentially, the presiding officer may preclude any member of the public who is defaming people in this way from speaking at future council meetings. I think that's too heavy-handed. I don't think we can do that.
Well, one of the things that we did do under the current rules, for instance, if a public, in public comment, if somebody speaks over the 3 minutes or if they're being out of order, that I can rule them to stop. If they don't stop, they continue to stop. But just what I've said is we'll go into recess and turn off the cameras until they quit the chambers. Then we also added to that, then you won't be able to
come back
until you're invited back. But
okay, well then, if you want that in there, we should put it back in.
I've always had a problem with that second part.
Okay, right.
Mm-hmm. The only thing is if somebody becomes violent and threatening,
right,
then you get trespass or restraining orders or something. But
that's for a higher authority,
right,
makes that decision.
Right, right.
You're going to get a judge to buy it.
I think it's right that we can just say, public comments cease, turn off the cameras, please, and we're not going in,
yep,
until you...
We're going to take a break until cool down.
Absolutely.
All right, 4A, public comment. Members of the public shall be permitted to address the council and all council committees on any matter for a period of 3 minutes. This period may be extended or reduced at the discretion of the presiding officer. Individuals wishing to speak will be recognized by the presiding officer and shall state their name and address to the administrative assistant to the city council. Providing officer shall rule out of order during the public comment session any remarks that clearly constitute defamation, with due regard for the distinction between elected officials and city employees who are public figures and those city employees who are not public figures. The presiding officer may order members of the public who break this rule to cease speaking. Councilors will not respond to any comments from the public. So we've sort of had that discussion in advance, I guess. 4.9, new business. Any councilor may introduce any written proposed order, ordinance, or resolution to be considered by the council at the next meeting, but not to be debated during new business. So bring it up, but it obviously wasn't on the agenda. Recess. Any councilor may call for and be granted a recess, the length of which will be determined by the presiding officer. 4.11, priorities of motions. When a question is under debate, the presiding officer shall receive no motion but these in the following order: to adjourn, to lay on the table, to call for the previous question, to limit or extend limits of debate, to postpone to a certain day, to commit, to amend, to postpone indefinitely. Are we good with all of those? That didn't change, did it?
I added, I think, to limit or extend the limits of debate. That wasn't in there. Mm-hmm. However, I might suggest actually striking the whole thing. The reason is the order of motions is well defined in
Robert's Rules of Order. Yeah.
So I don't know why it was in the last one, but I would almost suggest this is too restrictive. And some of the more fun ones you can do, like divide a proposal and take two parts separately. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't want to.
So you want to just strike 411 entirely?
Yeah, that's what I would.
Anybody got an issue with that?
I have no problem. I was going to say this is already laid out in Robert's Rules.
Exactly. And we've never, I mean, I can't recall us ever having a problem with this.
No.
I mean, our biggest problem was whether we wanted to, was it continue or table? I mean, that's the biggest.
Right. We do have a problem. We do continue to debate non-debatable motions. We
can't
do that.
And vice versa.
Yes, right. And we don't debate debatable motions.
So this whole one just goes, we'll take this out entirely. Okay. Because it's covered. 412, order and manner of speaking. No city councilor shall speak more than once on a question to the prevention of any other who has not spoken. It is desirous and is desirous of speaking. The presiding officer may allow a brief, immediate response to any statement posed directly to a particular city councilor by a city councilor. The presiding officer may request that any speaker discontinue an overly lengthy speech, but the right of a city councilor to speak shall not be limited unless a formal motion is passed to set limits on council debate.
Yeah, I added that last part just because I don't think it's appropriate for the office of council president.
Again,
it could be anybody, you know, not just Councilor Dwight, just say, stop talking. The appropriate way to do that, even though we may all wish that person to stop talking every fiber of our being, the appropriate way to do that would be with a motion to end the debate.
Yeah. And then it's a body, the whole body's telling them to stifle themselves.
Yeah, go stifle yourself.
Would that be in the motion? Would that be a motion to stifle?
Could we explore that?
Okay. Move to stifle.
May need that.
413, order during debate, no member should be interrupted while speaking, but by a call to order or a request for information or a question of privilege to appeal a decision from the presiding officer or for correction of a mistake, nor shall there be any conversation among the members while a paper is being read or a question stated from the presiding officer.
Right. I'm not talking about anyone in particular here, but it does happen on occasion,
it does
rare
happen.
Occasion that animated conversations are going on during the course.
With parties unknown sometimes.
Yes. I figure if we're doing the business, then we should be paying attention to the business and that. I mean, it's quite often we have to explain what it is we're voting on, which is always a little embarrassing as a body.
Where are we again?
I'm explaining to a member. Yes, if you vote yes, we do this. If you
this
vote
will
no,
happen.
We do that. What? Ooh, where did this come from? That's awkward.
Let's see. Voting. 414 voting. Deciding votes. The presiding officers will decide all votes, but if a member rises to doubt a vote, the presiding officer shall order a roll call vote. I'm good with that one. I mean, the charter.
Essentially, we've allowed anyone to call a roll call at any point.
Right. And that's still in here later.
Yeah. And we do so many roll calls and everything
now
because of the charter.
Now we do so many.
Yeah.
Now that we, because of charter, we do them for all orders and financial orders and ordinances that.
You wouldn't even notice another one.
No.
Okay.
Maybe with this new upgrade, we can get little buzzers and just so
we can put it on the new big 80-inch screen.
I can't tell when green though, so
yeah.
We got our little faces come up, a smiley face and a frown.
Right, that's, yeah, like the pain chart of those hospital.
I really voted no to that, but I'm a 10. Right, votes required to pass measures. Okay, the affirmative vote taken by a roll call of 6 members shall be required to adopt an appropriation order or transfer. But can we do those on a roll call? Can we do those? Well, those are roll calls.
Those are roll calls.
The affirmative vote taken by roll call of 6 members shall be required to adopt the zoning ordinance. In the absence of statutory requirements providing otherwise, the affirmative vote taken by roll call of 5 members shall be required to adopt any other ordinance. In the absence of statutory requirements providing otherwise, an affirmative vote of a majority of a quorum shall pass any other measure. And that good with the charter, right?
Yep, that's current practice.
Okay. Roll call votes, and this is a request rather than roll call votes. Any member may request a roll call vote on any question before the city council. The administrative assistant to the city council shall take the census of the council in that manner. Method of recording. Roll call votes shall be conducted by this method. The first roll call vote of every session of the city council shall be in alphabetical order. Each roll call vote after that shall progress to the next city councilor in the alphabet to be the first councilor voting. So that at the end of every 9 roll call votes, each councilor by alphabetical progression voted first in one of the 9 roll call votes. That's
couldn't be clearer.
Practice.
It's what we do now. It's what we force poor Pam to do is it's
Murphy.
When she called your name.
Remember that?
But in the beginning.
Well, it was your first roll call.
Very first meeting I did.
Murphy. Murphy.
Not what?
Present.
When a vote is passed, except for adjournment or to lay on the table, any member voting with the majority may move a reconsideration to be acted upon at the same meeting. Any member voting in the minority may move a reconsideration to be acted upon at the next meeting. Minority consideration shall have priority over majority reconsideration. Minority reconsideration shall be used to allow time for submission of new or additional information. Reconsideration shall not be used in a dilatory manner as defined in Robert's Rules of Order. No motion shall be twice reconsidered. And that, you know, what dilatory manner in the past has meant is you can't use it when there isn't another meeting or when to reconsider would kill it
right.
Procedurally.
Right.
So you can't at the last meeting of a session.
It was also used as a form of objection, just to put, particularly on a budgetary item or a budgetary deadline, that it was invoked each time so that we would miss the deadline on the applications. There might have to be some minor amendment in this because, for instance, the last meeting in December, if somebody calls for minority reconsideration, there will be no meeting that will be in that term with that body.
Well, now we have automatic carryover.
Well, that's right.
I wonder if that would change.
That's right. It'd be a reconsideration with possibly a new body. So, but yeah, with the automatic carryover. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so we would need to adjust that. I don't think so.
We wouldn't. Might be some strange sort of
appear again with a different cast of players.
Possibly.
Yeah. Okay. Ending time of council meeting. Council meetings shall end no later than 11 p.m. if the creek don't rise. Remote meeting participation. Councilors may participate remotely in meetings pursuant to the following regulations.
Can I comment on this at the outset, please?
Sure.
I think we passed this a couple of years ago. We took it verbatim from
the state.
The Attorney General's office.
So, anyway, just make that note.
Okay.
I don't know if this has been amended at all, but you're right. It was 2 years ago when promote participation was coming up, but I don't know if they've since modified it anyway.
Well, actually, and also our administrative assistant pointed out that just as in some rules, we may just refer to the charter, because why restate the issue? It might be that we could say remote participation shall be allowed according to whatever
conditions of the charter.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's, you know, it's handy because, well, I'm sure we'll all keep a final version of this at a quick, for a quick grasp. The charter is not so it's sort of nice to be able to have it in here just so you don't have to looking for the charter.
Yeah, that's one important thing. There have been a number of requests to possibly participate in remote and see if it works.
It's not the charter.
What's that?
What is this bedtime reading then if it's not the charter?
Good stuff in there.
It's just gentle recommendations. That's all. I'm not going to buy by any of these.
No.
It's a light comedy, the charter.
Exactly.
Any counselor who participates remotely and all persons present at the meeting location shall be clearly audible to each other. A quorum, including a presiding officer, shall be physically present at any meeting location, so the disembodied head can't count towards quorum.
Right. Okay.
Any counselor who participates remotely may vote and shall not be deemed absent. Any counselor may not participate remotely more than 6 times in a calendar year.
Okay. Counselor Adams raised something on that. He just asked if that is legal to have in there. And I looked it up, and I couldn't find any hard and fast rule why it has to be 6.
Yeah.
Other communities use 6, but mm-hmm. I couldn't find it.
Here's his comment. I'll read it in for the folks at home, playing this game at home. If legal, it should be stricken because a counselor could become ill and be unable to attend for more than 6 meetings and may choose to attend more than 6 meetings remotely. So I could tell, you know, you can't go to the Caribbean for the whole year and participate, but
I just have a vague memory about this with the district attorney's office with Martha Coakley. And that was one of the, and I just vaguely remember this is one of their rules. I don't remember the justification for it. I don't know what it was.
So maybe we just,
this might be another one.
Flag this one for Alan to weigh in on.
Yeah.
All right, so this one will be an Alan one.
I mean, we've had school committee members who went on sabbatical, go away for a year.
And a counselor would go to Europe, didn't you?
Well, that Mary, was, no, no.
Maria disappeared.
Was a school committee member, and she went to Germany.
For like
years. And she said,
years.
And this predates remote participation. She wanted to participate via fax, I think. And that was struck. That was not allowed.
And mental telepathy?
Yes, it was. I don't know. I don't know, we need a sender and a receiver, I don't know who can pick up her mental.
It's good to incorporate the facts into anything.
So I don't know, I mean, now we certainly have the means of somebody, if they were a professor, which we couldn't rule out as a possibility for someone running for council, is a professor who goes on sabbatical, who goes away somewhere and wants to participate remotely.
Mm-hmm.
It's worth checking out. They probably come up with us more than we'll come up with some other communities.
Yeah.
So.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. So we should probably,
we have a wish list for the Attorney General's office.
We're
the biggest pain in the ass of the Attorney General, as far as I can tell. As far as
we
splitting hairs,
challenge the Attorney General regularly.
Well, this quorum issue about the body over and over again. That's we'll trip up against that all the time. We can't be unique.
Mm-hmm. But we should, since this has been in here for a while and we have no meat. We have not established a means of implementation.
Soon, these guys come. These things come into play.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, what do? Put a 30-inch flat screen in the spot and hook a Skype up to it, so the person.
Well, it could be projected on the rear.
We don't want the missing counselor looming over you in an 80-inch screen. You know, a smaller one in their seat.
We'll give them a small inset or something.
An insert.
It'll be screen within a screen thing. We could see the football game, but you could see their head just speaking in
the sitting at the beach, smoking a cigar,
right.
Drinking out of an umbrella drink, you know.
Yes, right. All empty. Greeting the sun. Downward dog or something.
All right. let's see. Permissible reasons for remote participation. Any counselor may participate remotely if the presiding officer determines that one or more of the following factors make participation of the counselor's physical attendance unreasonably difficult: personal illness, personal disability, emergency, military service, or geographic distance.
That last one was always funny to me. It's just any reason.
Of course, first meteor. Cover that.
The counselor so-and-so is in a deep orbit today and they can't be with us.
Dishwasher is broken. Can't come in.
That is house.
Let's see, technology. The following media are acceptable methods for remote participation. Remote participation by any other means is not permitted. Accommodation shall be made for any counselor who requires TTY service, video relay service, or other form of adaptive communications. Telephone, internet, or satellite-enabled audio or video conferencing. Any other technology that enables remote participation and all persons present at the meeting location to be clearly audible to one another. But we may really want to, like, work with NCTV as to how this would happen.
Yep.
You know, because getting the remote counselor to hear everybody is going to be harder than getting everybody to hear the remote counselor. That's the tricky one. When video technology is in use, the remote participant shall be clearly visible to all persons present in the meeting location. Presiding officers may decide how to address technical difficulties that arise as a result of utilizing remote participation, but is encouraged whenever possible to call a brief recess while reasonable efforts are made to correct any problem that interferes with the remote participant's ability to be heard clearly by all persons present at the meeting location. If technical difficulties result in a remote participant being disconnected from the meeting, that fact and the time at which the disconnect occurred shall be noted in the meeting minutes. So does that mean you've got a mute button on whoever's
Yes. Well, my guess is if you just get their visual and you don't get any audio or just see them speaking but you can't hear them, that try to get that up.
And if the mariachi band comes by while they're speaking and you can't understand them anymore, you
a crashing ocean just is too the mic can't cancel that sound and you're completely inaudible. The screams of joy are kind of flooding you out. Just spend your remote participation.
Till things quiet down.
Right. We'll find a closet.
All costs associated with remote participation, if any, shall be borne by the counselor remotely participating. So no collect calls from Tahiti.
Well, no providing someone with like a laptop to record their Skype call or whatever. That's on that.
Technology's on you.
Yeah, it's on you.
Okay. Any counselor who wishes to participate remotely shall, as soon as reasonably possible prior to the meeting, notify the presiding officer of the desire to do so and the reason for and facts supporting their request. At the start of the meeting, the presiding officer
state the name.
Shall.
It's 416.
42. At the start of the meeting, the presiding officer shall announce or name of any member who will be participating remotely and the reason for their remote participation. This information shall be recorded in the meeting minutes. All votes taken during any meeting in which a member participates remotely shall be by roll call. Any counselor participating remotely may participate in executive session, but shall state that at the start of any such session that no other person is present or able to hear the discussion at remote location. Any counselor participating remotely who cannot certify that no person is present and or able to hear the discussion at the remote location may not participate. When feasible, the presiding officer shall distribute to remote participants in advance of the meeting copies of any document of exhibits that they may reasonably anticipate will be used during the meeting. If used during the meeting, such documents shall be a part of the official record of the meeting and shall be listed in the meeting minutes and retained in accordance with Massachusetts General Law 3822.
The only thing I changed, there were some he or she's that I changed to the collector.
Gender neutral?
Yeah.
Okay. Application, this rule shall apply to council committees. That's amendment. This section may not be amended unless it is in accordance with the mayor's remote meeting participation policy, Massachusetts General Law 30A, section 18 through 25, and 940 Code of Massachusetts Regulations 2910. Minutes of executive session. The city council shall create and maintain accurate minutes of all executive sessions in accordance with the following. Minutes shall set forth the day, time, and place, the members present, absent, a summary of the discussions of each subject, a list of documents and other exhibits used at the meeting, the decisions made, and the actions taken at each meeting, including the record of all votes. Any vote taken in executive session shall be recorded by roll call and entered into the minutes. Minutes of any executive session and notes or other materials used in the preparation of such minutes and all documents, exhibits used at the session may be withheld from disclosure to the public in their entirety, according to the provisions of Mass General Law, Chapter 4, Subsection 7, 26A, as long as the publication would defeat the lawful purpose of the executive session, but no longer. Approving minutes. Votes to approve executive session minutes may be, but are not required to be, taken in executive session. Review of deliberation on amendments to executive session minutes shall be done in executive session.
May I speak to this so far?
Yeah.
This is a good rule change because this fixes a problem we have.
An infinite loop.
Yeah. An infinite loop. Yeah. Having to go into session.
They're going to executive session to approve the minutes and then thereby creating a meeting.
For another executive session.
We have to release the executive session.
But it turns out that you do not have to be in executive session to approve minutes for executive session. And this basically the problem with our current rules is it conflates the approval of minutes versus the decision to release the minutes.
Exactly. So you can release the minutes in executive session. Right. You have to release them in executive session. But once released, you can approve them in a regular session.
There's actually two ways.
Ending the loop.
Yeah.
Actually two ways. According to Mass General Law, the council president, in consultation with the solicitor, can just decide him or herself to release the minutes.
Oh, but really? But without vote?
Exactly. But if it were me, I would want to vote. And so I put in there, if you want to vote about whether to release the minutes, then you must have that vote.
Does he have to wear a pointy hat when he does that? Can he just do it under a
cone of silence or something?
I could do that. Cone of silence.
Yeah.
I'm not leaving the chair. Just driving me nuts.
Stretching?
I'm stretching and the chair's making me crazy.
Is there a section in the rules about new chairs? right. So.
Is it that chair or would it all be the same?
This chair's falling apart in Marianne.
The counselor, you're going to get a comfy chair.
Good thing. I'll fucking sit in this one, but I'm not going to pass it on to Murphy.
We go a long way. Do you want me to ask them if they have any online sections?
I actually have some glue in my truck. I can fix this. I have the technology.
Is this wood glue or sniffing glue?
It's wood glue. Well, it's sniffing glue too. It serves two purposes. Gets me through the day. You guys, I know this part. You guys continue on. I'm going to
get the glue?
Yep, then I'm going to fill the city.
Okay.
Let the minutes reflect.
The council president is gone for his glue. Well, something has to hold the city together.
There's nothing.
Right. No, he has the glue in his truck. Let's see. We're down to what? As approved, releasing minutes. As approved in Mass General Law, Section 30A, Section 22G1, the council president, with the assistance of the administrative assistant to the city council and solicitor, shall, at reasonable intervals, not to exceed 3 months, review the minutes of executive sessions and determine if the relevant statutory provisions warrant continued non-disclosure. Such determination shall be announced at the City Council's next meeting, and such announcement shall be included in the minutes of that meeting. Wherever the Council President requests that a vote of the Council be taken to determine whether to release executive session minutes, that vote must be taken in executive session. All right. Upon request by any person to inspect a copy of minutes of an executive session or any portion thereof, the Council shall respond to the request within 10 days following receipt of such following receipt and such release any such minutes that would not defeat the lawful purpose of the executive session. So within 10 days following the receipt, and shall, are we missing a word here or no? Or did I just read it strangely?
Let's see.
upon request by any person to inspect or copy the minutes of an executive session or portion thereof, the council shall respond to the request within 10 days following receipt and shall release any such minutes that would not, okay, so it's fine. Any notes, documents, or other exhibits used in the preparation of the minutes of an executive session shall be retained for at least 60 days following the approval of the minutes of the executive session by the council. The council president shall periodically review said notes and other documents prior to the discarding or destruction thereof. 5, legislative process and proposed amendments. Timely filing. A rule was taken out. All orders, ordinances, resolutions, contracts, and any other written business to be transacted by the city council shall be filed with the administrative assistant to the city council at least 55 hours prior to the time and date of the meeting to allow for review and timely posting.
It used to be noon on the Tuesday before the meeting, but turning into the number of hours covers us if we have a meeting that's on a Thursday, especially.
That makes sense.
Noon on Tuesday is 55 hours before 7 o'clock on Thursday.
Does it involve Jeopardy music?
It might. Just might.
Pam, you'll just hear that in your head.
Just.
And when the music's over, no more.
Do you have a comment?
I'm not sure that the 55, I mean, to be perfectly honest, you know, everybody works to that Tuesday noon deadline to get me their items.
So that would stay the same.
Well, I mean, the hours is just in case.
It's fine for me, but I don't know about the quality of the agendas that can be produced. You know, working up against that deadline.
I mean, if we gave them an additional 7 hours, 7 p.m., so we had a 48-hour, because it can't be less than 48 hours, of course.
No, I think that the issue is, you know, I have counselors chomping at the bit. You know, if I receive things 55 hours, and the council believes that their packet should be ready by 12 noon on Tuesday, and there's a conflict there that needs to be resolved somehow.
Well, you can certainly make your own rule about when council packet printout should be ready.
Well, it's not my rule to make. It's sort of the unofficial rule of the council before I even came on the scene. Mm-hmm. So
I would say my opinion would be that's an internal policy that work out with the council president about whenever you wish packets to be available. But I mean, the rule should be for you. It should be so people aren't rushing to get something to you at the last minute. So here, put this in there and then print it out so I can go home, you know.
We're discussing
the
55 hours versus Tuesday at noon.
Right. What do you say?
Do you want to?
I think, you know, it doesn't really matter to me. I mean, I'm happy to produce an agenda, you know, keep adding things to the agenda, you know, with the World Wide Web. When counselors receive their packet, you know, via electronic, the only concern should really be the 48-hour rule, as far as I'm concerned. So if somebody wants to bring me something at, you know, 4:05 and have it be part of the packet, I don't have a problem putting it on the agenda. Where the rub is that, you know, for folks who get those paper packets, they want to be able to pick them up by 12 noon, and not you, Councilor Murphy.
No, but I mean, that's true. It's really hard to use highlighters on documents.
Yes, you can.
I just,
PDF,
you know,
you can highlight PDF.
I don't know.
Well, they're two separate issues.
I really just, you know, want to be able to create a quality agenda. you know, for you to, you know.
Well, it's also the public's ability to have access to the information that we have too, so that's kind of important.
So they get, you know, the access is pretty much e-access.
They get e-access.
It's.
Do you still send any paper agendas to anybody?
And they're in the mailboxes, right?
Well, yours I bring. I mean.
Yeah, just bring it.
Sorry.
It's not really an issue for me. It's not, you know, I mean, I want to give people as much time to submit their items and to be able to process it, you know, in a fashion that allows me the opportunity to get a good, you know, agenda published to the website. I mean, you know, if you give me something at 12 noon and the deadline is 12 noon and I'm trying to meet that deadline, I don't have the opportunity to review for discrepancies or, you know.
But isn't that the reason why we actually give you extra time above and beyond 48 hours? So that after you receive it, you have time to review it. Why not? Because the real window is the 48-hour open meetings.
That's my interpretation and my impression. It hasn't, and that's the way I treated the agenda. But that's not the, you know, the reality of some counselors, you know.
Well, again, my opinion is that that's an internal council etiquette issue that we have to enforce. I mean, do you want the 55 to be a lower number? Wouldn't that make it harder? It's totally up to you. I just thought that would be giving you extra time. But whatever facilitates your work best.
Are we going to recommend something here, or just let this float to the full body?
It doesn't matter to me.
Arguably, it also is. Changes with technology too as possibly, but if it doesn't matter to you, then fine. I mean, the concern is that there be a clean copy of something available to the public and to the counselors so that everyone's looking at the same thing in a timely fashion that doesn't put you at the 11th hour trying to contact a sponsoring counselor who has egregious spelling errors or improper format and structure on the proposal or whatever. So, I mean, I'm inclined to put anything on the agenda that's being sent forward unless it seems that we're getting too piled up and some things certainly could be passed on. That's when I say, let's wait for this one. We don't need it because we have a 13-page agenda or whatever.
What I would like to prevent is having Councilor LaBarge waiting in my office for an hour and a half until her agenda gets published.
Yeah.
And that's why it's a
and her expectation separate. Does not meet this 55-hour.
No.
So, and that happens rather routinely. And the reality is that everybody works to that deadline, whatever it is, at 12 noon on Tuesday. So between 11 o'clock and 12 o'clock, I might get 10 or 12 items from the mayor's office.
Right.
And that's, you know, I can't process those things in an hour and have the agenda be available for that 12 noon sort of cutoff. Mm-hmm. So there's no way to keep everybody happy, but something has to be done to sort of.
So do we make it 3 o'clock?
It's a separate issue.
4 o'clock?
It's a separate issue. When you receive, the purpose of this is so you receive this in more than 48 hours in advance, so you have time to do stuff with it. It's a separate policy, but when you make it available to the counselors or make printouts or even upload it to the website.
Yeah, I mean, because that's simply our own internal thing where the council president says your printed agenda will be in your mailbox in the council office at 3 o'clock, at 4 o'clock, at, you know, do not have expectations that it's going to be there before that.
get a copy.
It's also something we could, like, we can coordinate with the mayor's office without codifying it, the same, you know, 11th hour submissions. I understand how you guys work, but to drop this at 11:45 for a new deadline, it's not really fair.
You know,
well, as long as the turnaround is far enough off.
And you know, I don't want to set a hard and fast rule, because you know, I believe that there are sort of things that do come up that are sort of emergency. But I do get things like, you know, 15 appointments on 11 o'clock on Tuesday. How long did you know those appointments were coming forward? Mm-hmm. They can't all be emergency.
Especially when the term expired a month ago.
So that works two ways. One, a conversation with the mayor's office I have. The other is, I like the idea of making it 3 o'clock. Counselors may not pick up their packets sooner than 3 o'clock on
Tuesday,
or 48 hours before. That, because all the agenda has to be published by 48 hours in advance. It doesn't mean the counselors can have it in hand 48 hours in advance. And in fact, actually, it's more than 48 hours, because it goes to the one the council convenes, so that's 7 o'clock technically. And
right.
48 hours
Well, the only rub there is that it has to go to the city clerk's office to be published, and
right.
They close at 4:30, so. Mm-hmm.
So if we give it to them at 3, that might be too. Well, we can give, you could still give it to the city clerk's office in a timely fashion. It's just that Council LaBarge or Council or anybody doesn't have their expectation that their printed copy is going to be in their hands at noon time.
Right. Yeah, we just say printed copies in the mailbox at 3.
Right.
And that alleviates your having somebody drooling over your shoulder.
I can make a no hovering rule.
I don't care what the policy is. Yeah. I mean, regardless of what you make it, I'm just saying that the current reality is not, there's a disconnect between, you know, the expectations and what that 12-year deadline means to the council or to the mayor's office or to anybody. So it needs to be sort of, you know, either
I think it's reasonable to say the counselors cannot pick up paper copies earlier than 3 o'clock on that day.
On Tuesday.
But the electronic version will be available to anyone who clicks on their computer who needs to see it immediately. Yeah. It'll be available to everybody at the same time.
So the printing and collating part of it, you've got a couple hours to make happen after you hit go. Yeah. Does that work?
In theory? Like I said, it doesn't matter to me. It's just, you know,
I think we need to decide and move on, because this rule, I mean, I think it's a separate issue. I mean, do we want in the rule something about when paper copies are available? We can do that. That's fine.
I can simply declare that.
That's more like
With your apostolic authority.
Exactly.
Here. 3 o'clock. Okay. Presentation to council, mayor. Every new ordinance, order, or resolution, or other matter proposed by a city councilor, council committee, or the office of the mayor, including city departments and executive commissions, to be submitted for the city council action, shall be forwarded to the mayor, council president, and administrative. Do we need a comma there? Forwarded to the mayor, council president, and administrative assistant to the city council for placement on the agenda of the city council. Adding matters to council agenda. The council president shall have the discretion over the items added to the council agenda, except that if the addition of an item has been once requested at the discretion of the council president and is not placed on the agenda of a regular council meeting, then before the next council meeting, any two members of the city council may petition the council president, who shall then add the item to the agenda of the next council meeting. Does that make sense to everybody? Presentation and enacting style of matters. The matters shall be presented in the format indicated in the table below. And I really don't want to read the table. Is everybody good with the table?
Way of reading of table.
Way of reading of table. Okay.
Table.
table reading. 5142, clerk's administrative ID number. The administrative assistant city council shall assign each matter upon formal submission a unique identification number in the form of the last two digits of the calendar year, followed by an incrementally increasing number. The incrementally increasing portions shall reset to one every council session.
Strike the word clerks.
Right.
Hold on.
So no clerks, administrative ID number?
Right.
Okay. The council president may alter the short title of any matter to ensure accuracy.
I don't know how I feel about this, actually, upon looking at it.
So who has the authority? Is that the sponsor that has the authority to do the short title?
I guess. I mean, right, if you look at the idea is to have ordinances right. Like pretty, like they're in Congress or something.
Right.
And then you could have something like, you know, the George W. Bush Clean Skies Act, which
right.
The purpose of it is to destroy the sky, not to...
It's blue skies.
It was a blue sky?
Blue skies.
Okay,
yeah.
To make it brown skies.
Right.
But anyway, it's not part of the ordinance itself, so it kind of doesn't matter. And all, you also have to game out if we had the evil dictator council
right.
President, how would he or she
say,
play games?
Stupid ordinance.
Stupid ordinance. Summer 15.
Really stupid ordinance 15.
Even
the
stupider
stupid
ordinance.
Sponsor. Yet another piece of crap.
This title's really long.
Put up the ratings, though.
I could do it as an acronym.
Not to exceed 140 characters.
Yeah, I'm fine with that. I think at least to the sponsor and the short title. It's
so we're gonna nix this one?
Yeah.
Okay. Additions to the Court of Ordinances shall be indicated in bold and or underlined. Deletions shall be indicated by striking. So additions shall be indicated by bold and or underlined. Deletions shall be indicated by striking.
Change that semicolon to a period. It's never a good reason to use a semicolon.
Right.
Supporting documents. Maps and visuals, along with all other supportive evidence essential to a matter, shall be presented in a clear and intelligible way.
Yeah,
that's come out of Wayne giving us a picture of a gray blob with a number on it. We're supposed to be able to figure out
what
it is.
Now you can tell from this diagram that the water is flowing.
That's not particularly clear, but this, it has several boundary lines in there that you can see. Yeah, it's a leap of faith.
Can I just say that in Wayne's defense, some of those, you know, translations of, you know, mumbo jumbo to the screen
right.
actually happened. He'll send me a color copy. I just don't have the mechanism to get it to you. You know, once I scan it,
right.
It's no longer.
No, it's a black or white collection of fuzzy dots. And it's, yeah.
So when it comes to me, it's clear and intelligible. When it gets to you, it's just like.
Well, theoretically, with the new screening system, you'll be able to project actual JPEGs, the original JPEG of graph that you get. You'd be able to project that on the screen in color as it was sent to you.
And that'd be nice because then the people at home can see it rather than seeing it.
Right, and it shows up on their screen instead of somebody. It gets even worse because first we project it on the screen, this black and white image. The TV camera picks it up and projects it at home from this thing that's made. And you can't tell at all what the hell you're looking at.
So that's the Loch Ness Monster. I guess.
That's right. What the hell is that? It looks like I have cataracts. But so hopefully that improves with the system. So
I think the issue comes into play when it's scanned.
What's what?
When it gets scanned.
Scanned.
Yeah. See, I'm surprised. You know, if it's in there, it's probably either a PDF or a JPEG or something like that. We should be able to accommodate that.
Theoretically.
Yeah, it shouldn't be that hard to do.
I'm not sure about the JPEGs, but I'll check it out. Yeah.
I mean, you can insert them into just about anything you want. So. Okay.
Have you tried Civic Plus?
Civic Plus.
That's my platform.
Some challenges, yes.
Let's see. Okay.
Referral of matters to committees. In general, all matters may be referred to council committees for their report. Financial orders, no order or resolution authorizing a loan or levying of a tax or an expenditure of money, with the exception of the printing of the annual reports, shall be voted on by the city council until it has been referred to the committee on finance. It shall be the duty of such duty of such committee to report on the relation of each order, resolution, levy, or expenditure to the finances of the city. But new provisions shall not be added to such resolution, order, levy, or expenditure by the committee unless directly connected with the financial features thereof and by recommendation only.
That's kind of the same thing as we have now.
Okay.
Could be simplified if you want, but it does the trick.
Okay. Ordinances. No ordinance shall be voted on by the city council until it has been referred to the committee on legislative matters unless such ordinance is introduced and originates with the committee on legislative matters. So if it came from there, it doesn't have to go back.
Right.
Okay. Licenses and permits. Licenses and permits may be referred to the committee on community resources for the committee's recommendation. Prior to the discarded recommendation, is this a floating thing here?
What's that?
A committee's recommendation, and then at the.
You went backwards.
Did I go backwards?
Oh, well, you don't go backwards.
Glue is circling
backwards.
Five or
Paul
five.
Dead?
Yes, yeah.
Paul's dead.
I very Paul.
Solicitor review of ordinances. At or before the meeting at which the Committee on Legislative Matters considers any matter for approval and or recommendation, the city solicitor shall examine the matter's form and legal character. If there is a disagreement between the solicitor and the sponsor regarding the correct form or legal character that is not resolved within 30 days after the scheduled meeting of the Committee on Legislative Matters, at which the matter shall be on the agenda, or if the approval of the city solicitor does not occur within 30 days of said meeting, the sponsor may request the chair of the Committee on Legislative Matters that the matter be placed on the agenda of the Committee on Legislative Matters for discussion of whether or not the committee will approve and or recommend the matter to the city council. Is that clear?
This is roughly what we have now. The only issue is, it is kind of strange that we're writing such that, well, are we? That we're, I don't want to say we're requiring the solicitor to do something, which I don't think we can do. We'd have to write it more like we're not going to act unless we get the recommendation.
Right.
And then the whole process about ironing out a dispute might just be too complicated, frankly. I'm not sure. I would have to reread that again to understand it.
Is how much of this is new and how much of it is, because we don't have the don't
almost
know.
All of it is.
Yeah, that's the same. Never had to, and you'll know yeah. This has come up a few times, obviously, refuting or challenging the solicitor's opinion. Because there's no built-in line of appeal, it becomes a little tricky.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry to interrupt.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I would almost cut it off after the first sentence, because although we aspire to do what the solicitor says we can do, we don't have to.
Right.
I would almost just like to say,
just at or before the meeting at which the Committee on Legislative Matters will consider any matter for approval and or recommendation, the city solicitor shall examine the matter's form and legal character. Period?
Period.
Yeah. Strike the rest. Are we good with that? Withdrawal of matters. At the request of any sponsor of a matter shall be withdrawn from consideration in the city council and at all city council committees to which the matter had been referred, provided withdrawal be placed on the agenda of the city council meeting, no vote shall be required. However, if at that meeting all sponsors of the matter do not unanimously agree to the withdrawal of a matter, the matter shall not be withdrawn. However, at that time, any councilor shall, upon their request, have their individual sponsorship removed. Good with that? That's kind of the way it is, right?
So Donald Clark's.
There.
Do I stupid?
So,
was there his?
So if there's something in committee, then the sponsor has to bring it back to the city council and ask that it be withdrawn?
We'd ask for it to be withdrawn at city council, and that would be effective on committee.
I think you can either withdraw it on the council floor or before they see it on the agenda. So you wouldn't even have to, that's happened a couple of times, for instance.
Yeah, and the withdrawal trickles down to all committees that it's been referred to.
Right.
Yeah, the principle is we shouldn't have to have a whole vote on withdrawing, but it should be public.
Right.
Yeah, so
being withdrawn, yeah.
Three times, I withdraw the.
Right. So center court, for example. Two of the sponsors asked to be have it withdrawn so that they could be present to vote. So that was withdrawn, but we'd actually never mentioned it on the, well, actually explained it to Roger Sloan, but it didn't come up before us.
That's an issue of you placing it on the agenda.
Yeah.
So it's still floating around out there, it just hasn't come back to
getting
council.
Getting rid of it.
Didn't go away, it just didn't get on the agenda.
Right, didn't get placed on the agenda.
Whereas I had an ordinance about zip cars, which was a terrible idea.
Right,
and I didn't know how to get rid of it.
You withdrew it.
Yeah, but then we had this like public caning ritual. That
exactly.
And everyone voted.
How'd that work out for you?
Yeah. That was bad.
Well, that has value too.
Do you do the canings? Who does the canings?
No, the public.
The public.
The public. Or some councils often step up. The council does when the. Judith doesn't even know what the hell we're doing, we're talking about. Well, I will cane you then. I shall strike thee.
So I don't think I got an answer to my question. If you want to withdraw an item that's in committee, it has to go back on the city council agenda? That's what I'm reading here.
If it comes out of committee.
However, that if any meeting, however, if at, no, where is it? No vote shall be required, let's see. I'll just read it again. At the request of any sponsor of a matter shall be withdrawn from the consideration in the city council and in all city council committees to which the matter had been provided the withdrawal be placed on the agenda of a city council meeting.
Right.
No vote, so it's not a voted on, it's simply in there that it was withdrawn.
Okay.
So you don't have to vote on it, you just have to put it in the agenda, oh, by the way,
right.
The sponsor withdrew it.
No, but why it withdrawals.
Right, the counselor had some notions about Zipcar, he apologizes, and he's asked that.
I mean, they're all public meetings, they're all public meetings, but you mean...
But that way the withdrawal shows up in one of our agendas, oh, by the way, that's gone now.
You are arguing that it should be done
in public.
Any of the committee meetings are public, and they're all public meetings.
That's true.
But it's the demise must be in a council agenda, not just a committee agenda. So that it's clear that the sponsor wanted it removed.
Yeah, that's an interesting point that I think you're raising. I mean, my theory was that in general everything flows from the council to committees. But we are changing the rules of
committees
so that we can.
But you could, you know, a sponsor could show up at a committee meeting and say, all bets are off, I'm withdrawing this. Especially if, you know, if it gets sent out the first meeting of the month,
right,
and you're gonna withdraw it officially, but the next meeting is 2 weeks away, mm-hmm, you may wanna tell the committees as they go along, take it off your agenda, because it's gonna get withdrawn with the next published council agenda.
Yeah, it's more like, I'm sorry.
I just wanted to ask, when the mayor got up in finance and withdrew the Pfeiffer
right.
School, I would have to put that on the next agenda to say it's withdrawn.
I think we have to distinguish between withdrawing an ordinance from consideration or something from consideration and just not placing it on an agenda or deferring it to a future meeting. So my intention is, you know, my stupid car show ordinance, for example, it was on the council agenda for referral and we referred it to like two places. And then, including ordinance, I think it passed ordinance, then it came back. And at that point I was like, I don't want to vote on it anymore. I want to withdraw this. So we could either vote it down But that's the goal, to just like vanquish the ordinance, as opposed to, oh, we'll delay it, we'll put it on a subsequent, you know, withdrawing items from an agenda is different from withdrawing items
from consideration.
Yeah. So, but you're right, if that's to be clarified, we should clarify it. Because the mayor shouldn't have to have that on the agenda for a vote, under your scenario, your example.
Well, could we do it by just saying notice? Must be published in the next council agenda, just notice?
Or written request to withdraw, so that there's a document indicating that it was withdrawn.
So like a request to withdraw must be noticed in the next council, so that there's a paper trail as to where it went.
Right, but I also think that the request should come in form of writing, so that there is a document to refer to it, and that the,
So, at the written request?
Yeah.
Okay.
I actually used the wrong example. I was thinking of the Wireworks one, where at the time the mayor withdrew it, he did, I don't think at that point he had intended to bring it back to council, the easement.
In fact, he did it as a strategy. They put it on the agenda to scare the bejesus out of them and to make them respond to the easement request.
Okay, I know the solution to this. We just put it at the beginning, after a matter is first read. In other words, after it is already gone into the process.
Once it's been introduced.
Right,
Once it's been introduced, a formal withdrawal request.
Right.
Will require two of the sponsors, all the sponsors or two of the sponsors?
I should be unanimous. So Jesse and I have a tree ordinance.
Right, if you wanted to withdraw it.
You'd have to
vote. Like, no, I still like it, then obviously.
You couldn't withdraw it unilaterally.
That's all right, I'll take my name off.
Right.
You could take your name off, but you could like it go away. the residual sponsors could keep it going.
Yeah.
All right. So it would be that at the written request, we want to make it written.
Yep.
Of any sponsor. Oh, that the whole thing's gonna get clarified.
It should be
of the sponsors. At the written request of the sponsors.
Sponsor parenthetic S. And then
right. It should be withdrawal of previously introduced matters or heard matters or something like that, or read matters.
Following the introduction of any.
Okay.
Following the introduction of any matter at the written request.
And this does bring up the whole hearing discussion, what
right.
qualifies as a hearing.
Right, right.
Which
right.
you pointed out was
right.
rather interesting and I didn't know.
Right.
Introduction counts as a
next.
Reading. As
yeah.
a reading.
Yeah.
Introduction of an item counts as a reading. The two reading requirements can be satisfied even in committee, actually. And that other councils do that. One reading could be in committee and then second reading would be on the floor. But
that has never been our policy.
That has not been our policy, and I don't know if we want to wait.
That would be harder to change than noon on Tuesday.
But
intuitive head smoking.
It certainly would, yeah. But it's an interesting approach that a lot of communities do, that Ryan discovered this, and that was simply been our historical interpretation of what it means to have a reading. Reading
certainly
isn't a vote, necessarily.
Get things through the system faster.
It certainly would. And a reading, I mean, if you think about it, even quite literally, doesn't mean a vote. It's a reading. It's a reading. It's a, you know. It's
hey, y'all, we're thinking about doing this.
Yeah, we're doing the second reading.
We voted the second reading. The first reading is when we send it out.
Exactly.
The second reading is when it comes back to council.
And council for a vote.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I understand the value of that it has. It gives you the opportunity to find more challenges, but that's why you have reconsideration.
Well, and that's why we can suspend the second, do the second
and we do
reading
suspend
right away
it. Yeah, yeah.
If time is of the essence.
Right.
and the body agrees.
I mean, so far it's worked. It's just that it's Northampton's unique and clunky way of doing so.
Well, we got two readings coming up here.
could I actually amend, Councilor Murphy, your amendment?
Sure.
I think withdrawal of matter should start. If the council has previously acted on a matter, the matter may be withdrawn by this method, period, at the written request of someone.
But what constitutes previously acted?
Referral.
Referral, discussion.
Any, you know.
That's an introduction, but referral. So if it's on the agenda and we've acted on it, we've already referred it to committee, then it's susceptible to this rule.
Yeah, we're even had one vote.
Right. Even had a vote, you withdraw after one vote.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, you're kind of being the keeper of the rewrite of this.
I mean, one of the common reasons for a withdrawal, and I've done this once early on, was I introduced zoning, and it was clear there was a lot of public concern and thought about it, and it was moving through the process too quickly, and I withdrew it for community review, and withdrew it, and then reintroduced it afterwards, much changed, through about 7 months of deliberation by the community.
By so, process.
Yeah,
by
planning. So I said, and it's clear that this should not move forward without more community input.
Yeah.
And that's a good reason to withdraw something.
Yeah, so. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. Matters requiring two votes. To be approved, every matter shall have two separate votes on two separate days.
Unless otherwise provided in the rules.
Unless otherwise provided in the rules.
Change meetings to votes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Matters requiring one vote. In accordance with Section 6.1 of the Charter, administrative orders submitted by the mayor shall have a hearing, and only one vote of the council shall be required to either approve or disapprove the orders. And then we add licenses, approvals of minutes, acceptances of reports, petitions, and appointments shall only require one vote for approval.
I think the most discussion-worthy thing is whether administrative orders should have two votes or one. Strongly about it. I sort of feel like the mayor is administering the city, has a proposal for us, and we're up or downing it. And then
one's enough.
Yeah, and we can't amend it anyway, which is usually the purpose of two meetings. Anyway.
So
right. Yeah. Just some clarity of this.
Enrollment committee. When a matter has passed the required number.
I just wanted to say I think you should probably consider taking out, leaving it only, require only one vote, and then taking out for approval.
Where is that?
The end of that, of 5-6.
Want to read the whole thing?
Licenses, approval of minutes, acceptances of reports, petitions, and appointments shall only require one vote.
Period.
Yeah, that's good.
Because they could get one vote for disapproval.
Exactly. Or acceptance.
Or whatever you want to call it. The enrollment committee, when a matter has passed, so I just did that, passed the required number of readings, it shall be assigned to the administrative assistant to the city council and signed by the enrollment committee consisting of two city councilors. Automatic carryover. Matters not approved on second reading by the city council by the end of the current session, so automatically carry over to the next session of the city council and shall remain in the council and in all committees and executive commissions to which they have been referred at the start of the next session unless a matter has already failed on the first reading or a matter has received a negative recommendation from the Committee on Legislative Matters or the city council by majority vote prevents automatic carryover of a matter to the next section. For this purpose, the city council president shall place a list of pending matters on the agenda at the final meeting of the session. Only one vote shall be required to prevent automatic carryover, or
none of the sponsors of the matter will be serving in the next session of the city council. This is all new stuff.
Yeah, that's just so we don't have to affirmatively vote to carry something over. It's the opposite.
Yeah, to affirmatively vote to move it out.
It's also, we just want to prevent things from dying procedurally. If something doesn't pass, we want it to be because we voted down.
By intent, not just by, oops, I forgot it.
Do you have some things on your list?
We do.
You have some things to be forgotten?
We'll have to go. We'll have to go over that. We have three meetings left, so.
Yeah, but you know, I still think that this should be voted on by the new council.
The rules?
Yeah. If you want to change, I mean, if we change the rules, we should change them at the very end of the last meeting of the session, because they change everything. You know, sort of like changing our DNA and then having another meeting. We probably should do it at the end of the last session, so the committees don't change and the rules don't, you know, people.
Right, well, it wasn't to go into effect until the next time, maybe.
Okay.
Yeah.
Does have an effect if they, we could pass on a first reading, pass on a second reading in the council.
It's a carryover.
But there wouldn't be automatic, we'd have to vote to carry it over, because there is an automatic carryover until the next, so it gets a second reading, so.
Speaking of one vote, are you thinking that approval of the rules will require two votes?
I think that because this is an order, it requires two votes. What do you think?
Well, with the suspend rules,
The mayor's administrative orders only requires one vote.
Well, that's not clear.
Well, in your rule, well, the way you've written it, I mean.
Are you saying, but this will be adopted under our current rules?
Right.
Yeah.
Right, so in the future, are you thinking that this will move forward with requiring two votes in the future?
The way I try to write this is everything defaults to two votes unless specifically listed as one vote.
Which we read already.
Right.
Yeah, I know. I was just thinking administratively it was sort of parallel to the mayor's.
Oh, I see what you're saying, right.
The mayor's.
Yeah.
So you're suggesting that we
do one vote for ourselves, too.
Rules require one.
So we just don't have to think about it.
That's interesting.
It's one. If it's one for him, it's one for us.
So we could add amendments to the council rules. I mean, the only difference is, we can't amend the mayor's administrative orders, but we can amend our own. So that's one wrinkle, but I take your point. That's interesting.
Well, you know, the first meeting of every session, council votes its officers, elects its officers, and then it votes to accept the rules. So we got to do that, and that's only done with one vote. That's not a two vote, but we vote to accept our rules. They're introduced, at least that's the way it
works. Well, I'm thinking we get them all done, and then we'll just adopt them in the new council.
Right. What I'm saying is that's one reading. We don't do it in two readings. When we accept our rules, we don't accept it. We don't do it in two readings. I mean, because technically, it'd be chaos. We wouldn't have to abide by any rules until the next meeting.
So we had a second reading.
When you've amended them, you've done two readings.
Yes, that's true. We've altered the rules as opposed to accepting the rules. So that's true.
So we can have a meeting without civility.
I see that.
And the other point is, when you think of the purpose of two readings, it's more for, it's also for the public.
Right.
Whereas the rules are almost
only apply to us.
They don't really worry about our rules that much.
It's true. It's why. Theoretically, once upon a time, we were allowed to do all this discussion in camera, which was what Councilor Bardsley did in a special classroom at Smith College. They granted him for invoking to get a classroom, and that's where the counselors met in violation of quorum and met, discussed, and debated, not in public.
Well, should we add amendment to rules in the list of things that requires one vote?
Sure.
Go back to Tom, whatever that was, and just put it in there with the one vote stuff.
Okay.
Do we want to read the appendices? Have there been changes in there? Is that all?
No.
So that we don't need to go over here because it's the same.
The only ones I added examples of presentation.
Right. Oh, just so the display stuff is new. But so what's your pleasure since we've had our way with this? Shall we have Counselor O'Donnell create a final version and send it to the solicitor and put it on an agenda at some point.
I would like to move to amend, I don't remember the rule number, it's the one where the council president assigns chairs. We've had two admin objections, and I don't feel strongly one way or another about this. And in light of the objections, I mean, the only advantage I can see to it, of course, is that it just streamlines things in some level, but it also incorporates in the president a lot of power that they could either curry favor with particular counselors by giving them chairships. I mean, we're not the Congress, so, and at the same time, it could also create committees with committee chairs that literally could subvert the intent of the council, and maybe even the intent of the administration of the mayor. So,
and I mean, it is. I think I concur with that because it is a considerable authority to comprise the committees to begin with. It then on top of that, I think it's a tad much to ordain their chair in advance. That, you know, because it is 2 years worth of kind of the way things are going to go, and even more so in a council that remains so much the same.
Well, remember, we also gave the authority to the presiding officer to remove somebody from a committee during the midterm. So that seems to be enough authority in that case that would
cover that. Doesn't play well with others, you can.
I mean, when Councilor O'Donnell and I were discussing this, it seemed like an interesting idea, and it just seemed like it would streamline stuff. But I have no I have no problem having it struck based on the admin objections of two councilors. Mm-hmm. I think that.
So just and to appoint its chair goes away.
Yeah, okay. The committees can appoint their own chairs.
We have to amend two things. Yeah. We have to amend two things. That goes away, and then also on page 8. Under powers and duties of council committees, the following shall apply to all committees unless otherwise stated. Election of officers, council committees shall elect officers
right.
from among the members, such as chair and vice chair. Mm-hmm. No, I think that's right. I think it's
yeah.
good to propose and discuss, but yeah.
I also like to note for the record that Council Murphy has an anti-Christmas cup from Starbucks.
What?
You have followed the controversy with the
cup? No!
Starbucks has a red cup for the holidays, and people are upset because it doesn't say anything other than that it's red, and it's killing Christmas. Just to let you know. Just saying.
Can I also, 6.1 in the appendix?
The appendix? Good lord.
Sorry. Back to the end.
Special permitting.
So the purpose of intent really does not do justice to what it is that this section is supposed to cover.
You mean 6.1?
Maybe it's just me.
Or is it just the purpose intent paragraph?
Yes.
Let me read it for the folks at home. These bylaws and rules of procedure shall govern the operation of meetings and business before the Northampton City Council and carrying out its duties and responsibilities as assigned to it by the ordinance of the City of Northampton and the general laws of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, where there appears to be any conflict between those rules and either state law or city charter, the law and charter shall govern. And I mean, I would think it should say the charter and ordinances. Well,
I would think it should say that this section applies only to special permitting and grant authority at some point in that little paragraph there.
This is strange.
Is this just the way it is?
Carrying out its duties related to.
Let's see what it is now.
I think that's exactly what it is now, right?
Okay.
That's the issue. It's just
oh, okay.
just never really made sense to me. It's just like, it seemed like a whole nother set of rules for the council.
Is this required by law? Where is this?
This might be something that we ask Alan to review when Alan looks at it to say, is this correct or should this be something else? Because we're worried about it's conforming. He's our chief conformist.
Yes.
Right. You see what I mean, Ryan? It
just
seems like it's...
It speaks to the rules in general, not...
Right, not to the specific...
I say strike the whole thing and see if Alan has a problem with it.
See if he notices?
I think you're right, man. I say strike purpose and intent.
The whole thing?
Purpose and intent and those two paragraphs.
Take out for any item of parliamentary procedure not governed by these rules or appropriate laws, the provisions. Well, we should leave that one in.
Yeah, but that's...
That's already in there, actually.
Yeah,
that's... It's in there earlier.
Yeah, it's earlier. Yeah. These rules are things at the very beginning.
All right.
More or less, mm-hmm. Yeah.
So from here, you want Ryan to reconstitute it and ship it to Alan?
That would be my pleasure.
Comment. And then we'll consider it, you know, because I, do you want, because it was sent to ordinance, do you want us at this point to, because what we were talking about was sending it without recommendation to the solicitor to get it come back to you as council president, then to be taken by you from there and put on the agenda as you see fit. That makes sense.
Yeah, I think that's fine.
That makes sense to you?
Okay. So do you want a motion for a neutral recommendation from ordinance as amended, including all the amendments we made last time?
Yeah.
Today?
Yeah, that sounds good.
So I make that motion, just a small thing to clarify. Under the one vote thing, I'm going to add amendments to the council rules right after appointments.
Okay.
So.
Okay. All right. And I'll second that. Any other?
No, just that the solicitor has seen this in previous forms, and I think it's fair to pass it as is, knowing that there's small changes in the review.
All right. And then, so as amended, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Then it'll go from here to the solicitor for one more review in its current form, so that when you bring it back, you can say, committee's worked on it with, you know, in 2 minutes?
Yes, I do. Two separate amendments. We could always tackle this in council, but one's about the independent auditor, and one's about
right.
Jurisdictions.
We deferred that.
Yeah.
We deferred that from the last meeting.
Would you want to do that in council when you get it back? Or do you want the solicitor to?
I don't want to do one of them in council. I want to do at least one here in ordinance. I think it actually would be pretty quick and painless.
Which one was it?
It's about.
You gotta go.
Yeah.
Right. My truck's unlocked. There's a roll in the door.
Which one was second? Okay. That's okay. Which one
The other one was the auditor.
We'll grab one.
Oh.
I'll grab one. Bye.
Bye. Thank you.
So, is this the third in your proposal?
I mean, these are. In the rules that we just voted on, there's a placeholder for language about the outside auditor, and that would be that.
This would be the...
It would almost be appropriate to talk about in council. That would be fine.
Mm-hmm.
The other one is more of a technical issue about the committees and specifying the jurisdictions. So. I mean, can I move reconsideration of...
Our recommendation?
I mean...
Sure, we're all among friends here.
I'm not voting, so it's all on you guys.
All right. So, do you want me to read this for the record, or do you want to?
We have two amendments here. I definitely would like to do this one.
All right. So, why don't you propose?
All right.
Propose it.
So I propose an amendment to add specific jurisdictions for each committee. And
is this a four-page
one? Yes, it is.
Okay.
This is the one dated 10/23/15.
if I can read at the end under 2.6.2.3, it would read, requests of city, this is under requests to appear before committees. Requests of city departments, boards, and commissions. At the request of any member of a committee and through its chair, a committee may request members of any multi-member body or city employee, provided that body or employee thereof falls under the committee's specific jurisdiction, as provided in this section of these rules that establishes the committee, to appear before it to provide any information relative to services, functions, and powers within the jurisdiction of that person and not within the jurisdiction of the school committee. Other requests, another section, through its chair, a committee may invite individuals, organizations, or bodies not falling under the committee's specific jurisdiction as provided in the section of these rules that establishes the committee, provided the question of the invitation be first placed on the committee's agenda and receives a majority vote of the committee. And then just the word notice about how many days in advance. So that applies to all committees. And then for each of the committees, starting with the committee on finance, this would add section 2.6.1.1.5. Jurisdiction relative to departments, boards, and agencies, finance department, treasurer, collector, auditor, assessor, management information systems. Under the committee and community resources, it would add jurisdiction relative to departments, boards, and agencies, arts council, planning and sustainability, housing authority, parking enforcement. Under city services, it would add jurisdiction relative to departments, boards, and agencies, recreation, veterans affairs, council on aging, Forbes and Woolley libraries, community and economic development, police, fire, rescue, health department. Under committee on legislative matters, it would add jurisdiction relative to departments, boards, and agencies, legal services, city clerk, license commission. And finally, under committee on public works and utilities, it would add jurisdiction relative to departments, boards, and agencies, department of public works, central services, and building inspector.
It's probably building commissioner.
Okay. Is that okay?
And for whatever the new version of ROW is, would it make sense to allow them any department affected by an ordinance or something in front of them?
Okay.
Because they...
Basically anybody.
Yeah, basically anybody, because if an ordinance comes, everything could end up there.
Okay.
So if there's an ordinance there that... Because everything gets sent there.
Right.
That they might have that for, we wouldn't want to exclude anybody from that committee because everything's going to go through
right.
that committee.
Right.
And again, these were invitations because we can't compel executive people
exactly.
to come.
Except through the charter.
Except through the charter.
We actually can't compel citizens to come.
Yeah.
We don't have subpoena
right.
power. But we can ask and invite citizens
or administrative
committees.
Yeah.
I just want there to be, committee has a jurisdiction, and if there's a committee about city services, I don't necessarily need it asking, the planning board to come, or, first night to come, and so on and so forth.
Invite,
yeah. So for legislative matters, it could read jurisdiction to departments, boards, and agencies, legal services, city clerk, license commission, and any other body
that apply.
With business. And anyone with business.
And any other city.
Department. Yeah. Any other department.
With business before the committee or with whatever.
Right. The other department representative that has.
Yeah. Because everything ends up there. Not that you're inviting people all the time, but. Since everything flushes through there in the end, they should be able to invite anybody
flushes.
Affected by something on their agenda.
Okay, and then I'll add, and any other department, board, or agency.
Okay.
And then the auditor one, you want me to?
Yep, it's up to you.
Okay, so this one, so that you want to add
yep.
to further amend, and then this one, this is selection of outside auditor pursuant to section 7.6 of the charter. The city council shall select an independent auditor according to the following provisions. The city council shall by October 1 of the fiscal year for which the audit is to be done establish a select committee for the purpose of making a recommendation on an independent auditor to the full council. So that would be a select committee, not finance.
Okay.
The council shall award a contract to audit on or before March 1 of the fiscal year for which the audit is to be done. The city council shall require the report of the audit to be filed in final form with the council not later than January 15th in the year following the award. And the council shall rotate the independent auditor and shall select a new independent auditor not less than every 5 years.
That's the sticking point. Yeah.
The rest of it I can tell you
is
our finance director likes nice and clean.
So a mandatory change of auditors.
Every 5 years.
Memorialized in the
council orders.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that one, I don't mind flushing this forward because frankly, I'd like the solicitor's opinion on it, but we should certainly in council discussion indicate that that's setting in stone that policy.
Right.
That love them or not, they got to go every 5 years.
Right. Yeah. And that would be controversial, naturally.
Yeah. So for the other one and this one, I'd second those amendments.
Okay.
You know, with the clear understanding that this one's, I want the solicitor's opinion, can we do this? And then we should definitely, when we have this in council, point out the fact that we're committing to this one.
Okay.
For the first time, so.
Okay.
All right, so you moved it.
The amended version with all the other amendments.
And these two.
And these final two amendments.
Yeah. So, I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, you're good with that? So, the plan from here will be, you're gonna make a final version of it.
Right.
From notes notes and Pam's notes.
Yeah.
Yeah, you gotta put your heads together and then it'll go to the solicitor, and then it'll come back to you after the solicitor blesses it, and then you can choose to bring it to the big show whenever it's ready.
Yeah, hopefully soon.
Yeah, because it certainly wouldn't have the, be nice to at least have the discussion this year, even if we don't adopt it till the first meeting.
Right.
Get the dirty work over with.
Right.
Maybe and then forward a copy to our new member so they can.
Well, it'd be great to actually have it vetted now.
Yeah.
Because so then we incorporate as a new council. We don't have to start hacking out the rules all over from the beginning. So. But yeah, there's one new member. I mean, it's going to make his head explode anyway. I mean, it's just, you know, here's your rule book.
Trust
you want to memorize by the second meeting, so good luck.
Trust us, you'll like it.
You'll love it.
You're going to love it.
And you have to be able to cite it by proper reference number.
drop one every now and then. Okay, what's that episode?
Exactly.
What's Councilor Labarge doing when she wants to suspend rules? She'll have to have a whole new.
She just moves to suspend rules.
Well, she always puts rule 14 or something.
Well, 14 because she knows I'm up. Yes. Yeah. This is going to throw this off.
Now it's 1.4. So you divide by 10.
Okay, there we go. I'll say that. Divide all original rules by 10.
And carry the 10. One.
All you do is move the decimal point over. Never mind. We'll just suspend rules.
Find a protractor under your chair.
And an abacus with every in every desk.
And I assume I can make spelling corrections and things like that.
Could I have a motion to adjourn again?
We didn't make one yet.
Oh, yes, we did.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah, you did. 7:00. Councilor Donald made it. You seconded it.
A motion to adjourn?
Yeah, but then you had to go throw your amendments on. Then you threw your amendments on.
I don't know where to go. I don't know why I would have done it.
I think the administrative assistant is planting things in our head.
All power emanates actually from the administrative assistant's office. And I've
so the
you want,
come
you
on,
want
come on, motion.
Motion.
You want a motion to
adjourn.
I move to adjourn.
Not debatable.
All in favor?
Aye.
Good job.
Thank you.
Good job.